It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
Oceanside Christopher is a Catholic credit union, and they care about the Catholic community on Long Island.
It's a community. You come here, you feel like you know everybody in here. You feel comfortable and always get great service.
You don't get that feeling when you go somewhere else to a commercial bank or even another credit union for that matter.
You come in here, everybody knows your name. It's always a hassle-free environment, and it's just very enjoyable to do business here.
We love that we're always greeted by a smile. Everybody here is so nice. We love the hours, the local feel of it. It's just like being a part of home when we come here.
I love this place. It's because it's a natural place. I do my finances, but I also get to know my faith is being represented.
And when I use my Oceanside Christopher Visa card, a portion of my purchase goes to support Catholic parishes. Hello and welcome to Everyday Faith Live. Lots of news to cover today, so let's get started. Today's Good Friday, which commemorates the passion and death of Jesus on the cross. The traditional practice of praying the Stations of the Cross is also done each Friday of Lent, and every year the Pope leads a procession of pilgrims in praying the Stations of the Cross in the evening of Good Friday in Rome's Colosseum. At each station, the Pope recalls the particular moment of Christ's passion and reads a reflection.
This year, Pope Francis has invited Archbishop Brigantini of Campobasso Bolana, Italy, to prepare this year's meditations for the Stations of the Cross. In an interview with Vatican Radio, Archbishop Brigantini expressed his gratitude to the Holy Father and was honored to prepare the meditations. On this occasion in particular, he said, "I have truly felt that passion of Jesus intertwined with the passion of man in prayer and in reflection."
According to the Archbishop, the Vatican entrusted him with the theme, Face of Christ, Face of Man, a theme he noted which is very wise. He said, "The more you read the face of Jesus, the more you feel that he is incarnated in thousands of sufferings of our time and that he is already present in every tear."
The Archbishop also noted that the Stations of the Cross in itself is a testament to the Holy Father's recent apostolic exhortation, the joy of the gospel, where he calls for the gospel to be lived and brought to the margins of society. He continued to say, "For me, the joy of the gospel has become a very lucid word that precisely helps us to read and understand the tragedies of today through the luminous and above all merciful face of Jesus."
These days of the Triduum are days that are filled with symbol, rich symbol and rich tradition for us. Of course, Good Friday, which we really didn't mention yet, is of course the reading of the Passion from John's Gospel, which is beautiful and really just a very touching way for us to recall the story of our faith, and then the veneration of the cross and the reception of Holy Communion, right?
It's one of our very ancient liturgies. Mm-hmm. I just love Good Friday. You can't go wrong. I mean, if you just follow the book, it's so beautiful. But one of the, each of those individual components is really beautiful, but the veneration of the cross, when each person in the assembly in procession goes to the cross and venerates it, it's just so beautiful.
Yeah, yeah. And I know another component of this day, which you don't see everywhere, but it's part of it, is a beautiful prayer service that is often celebrated called the Seven Last Words of Christ, which is something that is usually from noon to three, right, in parishes or cathedrals where they do that as well. And that also is usually a musical cantata or a musical pieces on the seven last statements of our Lord on this way of the cross and on the cross, right?
That's right. It's one of those traditions that grew when the actual liturgy of Good Friday had not been in practice. But now, if you're going to participate in the whole Triduum, the 3 o'clock service, which of course can be repeated in the evening, mm-hmm. That's really the service you want to participate in. The other things are additions, and that's
sure.
all.
Oh, of
that's
course,
all wonderful.
Yeah, they're really important. You know, each year on Holy Saturday during the Easter Vigil, thousands of men and women are received into the Catholic Church in the United States and throughout the world. Parishes welcome these new members through the Rite of Christian Initiation of Adults, the RCIA, and at a liturgy bringing men and women into full communion with the Catholic Church. Well, joining us today is Father Lawrence Iñiguez, who heads the RCIA process at Maria Regina Parish in Seaford. And thanks for being with us, Father Lawrence.
Good morning, Father.
We live across the hall from one another, so that's why I kind of tagged him to do this. But you lead this in the parish. Is it a good experience for you to do
it
this?
It is. Believe it or not, I just can't drive too much joy, a lot of joy in doing it. And when you get to see these people that really wants to become Catholic, it nothing but moves you a lot. And the kind of joy they have in their heart in becoming Catholic makes me appreciate more of what we have.
Now, they've gone through a process with you, so you've gotten to know them very deeply, I would think.
Deeply, I know them, I know their husband, their wives, their family, and it kind of that they rely more on me. Sometimes they come and tell me their personal stories or what is going on in their lives or things like that. And it just make me, I take them as my brothers or my sisters. It's just, I love them so much. And it makes them feel at home into the community they are just coming into. They feel accepted. Mm. And one great thing I love about it is that the people in our parish love these people so much.
It's true. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's so amazing.
Now, do you have other people who are with you in this process?
Yes, we have sponsors, and I have Margaret O'Connor, which is just helping me a lot. One thing I do with sponsors is that I try to get a sponsor that they are familiar with, those that they already know before coming to the process. And I have these three siblings, so their neighbor is just very active in the church. So I asked the neighbor to be their sponsor, and they love it so
much. Isn't that great?
They took these people as their children, mm-hmm. and it made them feel at home. And it's really a very good process in the church that it shake my faith a lot.
Sure.
Because it gives me joy when I'm with these people. And when they go home, I miss them a lot. And on Sunday, I look forward in meeting them again.
You know, I noticed too, this year, particularly in our parish, we have a family that's going through the RCIA, which I guess is not all that uncommon. Yeah. But that's particularly beautiful, isn't it? Like where there's a dad and some children and a mom involved, that's really something, right?
Yes, and these families that their parents, mom and dad, always there mm-hmm. on Sundays to go through this process with them. It's just very amazing.
I remember last year at the Easter Vigil at Maria Regina, this is where I live also, we baptized one of the New York Jets. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
And he had a beautiful experience of like coming to meet our community yeah. and mm-hmm. being a part of our community, which is very, very welcoming. And I think that's something that's good to point out to people, that the RCIA actually allows the entire parish to really be part of the welcoming community,
exactly,
right?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's really, one thing I love about it is that like the scrutinies, we try to do the scrutinies, different masses, so people know what is going on in the parish. And you see them coming, asking questions. Oh, this is great, this is amazing. So the community is into this. Mm-hmm. They love these people coming in. And it's just amazing. The only one word I can use to describe this, amazing.
That's when you do the liturgy well, right?
Exactly
right. It works, it really works.
It works.
No, it's a good thing.
This
well, Father
great.
Lawrence, thank you for
Look
being with us.
To it.
You know what I also want to say, too, is that coming out of his room, I can always hear very, very loud the TV has Telecare on. So thanks for watching Telecare.
Thank you for changing my channel.
Yes, I always put it on Telecare form so you can watch it. But it's good to have you here. Thanks for being
good
with
to
us.
Be here. Thank you.
Newly
sister.
Ordained
thank
priest, and he's just got so much energy and so much life. It's just great to be with him. So thanks so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Easter Sunday is the most important religious feast in the Christian liturgical year. It celebrates the resurrection of Jesus and the importance of a God in our lives. Bishop Murphy has released his 2014 Easter message, and he said, "On this Easter day, I greet all of you just as the risen Christ greeted the apostles in the upper room on that first Easter. Shalom, peace. I pray that Christ's peace may dwell in your hearts and be shared by us all this Easter and every Easter of our lives here on earth. His peace is God's gift to us that we might be free from sin and from all distress, because his life dwells in us and we dwell in him."
Bishop Murphy continued, "Yet we know we continue to live in a world of lights and shadows. In such a world, we must join our lives to Christ and share his mission, the mission of the whole church. The whole church makes our own, that the world may believe." St. Paul is right. We were darkness, now we are light. That means that we must be light to the world as Christ is the light that illumines our hearts and guides our journey on earth. Be confident that you share his mission.
In the conclusion of the letter, Bishop Murphy stated, "Be confident that you do so as a precious part of Christ's body, the church. Together, we are co-responsible to bring Christ to the poor, the vulnerable, the marginalized, and together we are co-responsible to show the world Christ's life by our lives, Christ's love by our loving concern for others. May this simple message be profound and resound in our hearts as we greet one another this Easter." Beautiful message once again, and really kind of talking about and overlapping to a certain degree the bishop's pastoral letter, which was issued this year, about the fact that we as church are called to bring Christ to others and how important that is, right?
That's right. And of course, it goes back also to the Pope's exhortation, joy of the gospel. So much is being said today of being in Christ and being joyful. Mm-hmm. And I think that comes through with everything that the bishop is writing.
And you'll see at the Easter Vigil, which we'll be broadcasting to, Bishop Murphy's homily, be based slightly on this, of course, along with, of course, resurrection themes. And then also, you'll see that on Sunday, different homily, of course, at the 11 o'clock Mass, live from St. Agnes Cathedral as well. So we have a lot of Masses that are going to have a lot of homilies, but all of them are going to resound, I think, with this gift of hope, the power of us reaching out to people who are all around us, rich and poor, those who are afflicted, and those who are in need of healing. All right, we're going to take a quick break. More EFL News right after this.
Hi, I'm Chris Burke, an actor who happens to have Tourette syndrome. Join me in watching some great stories about inspiring people with Tourette syndrome.
Somebody asked me what Down syndrome is. I told them it's just an extra chromosome in your body, and it just makes learning a little more difficult.
I just hope many people with Down syndrome can follow their dreams and the passion of what they love to do.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about.
I think she has more abilities than I do. Just to emit this incredible love that everybody was drawn to.
I thought his story was amazing. I thought it needed to get out there to inspire other people.
My name is Annie.
I'm a Salem Barlow.
I'm Megan Ritt.
Serena.
This is Bates.
And this is my
great story.
My great story.
This is my great story. You can watch at ndss.org/stories.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. The Vatican recently confirmed that Pope Francis will visit South Korea in August. Let's take a look at a clip from Rome Reports.
With one of the world's most dynamic churches, South Koreans have yet another reason to be proud. Seoul's Archbishop Andrew Yim Sung-yung is now a cardinal. He leads a growing church with one of the highest conversions of Catholics and a big missionary spirit, and that will be on full display for Asian Youth Day, especially since the Vatican just confirmed that the Pope himself will be a guest from August 14th to the 18th. Even though there were rumors, an official announcement had not yet been confirmed until Monday. As the cardinal prayed for the Pope's visit, he noted that his predecessor, Benedict XVI, visited all continents except Asia. This year, the South Korean city of Daejeon will host Asian Youth Day in the month of August, where thousands of young adults will celebrate their faith. The cardinal emphasized that Jesus was born in the heart of Asia, and the Pope's visit, he said, will inject hope and usher in a new era for the church in Asia. Despite its long history, Catholicism is still relatively new to Korea. In fact, it was lay people, not missionaries, who established the first Catholic communities in the peninsula back in the 18th century. It's a testament to the missionary spirit of the local church, a spirit that at times came at the cost of lives. It's expected that during the visit by Pope Francis, he will preside the beatification ceremony of 124 Korean martyrs, victims of religious persecution.
The official motto for this upcoming trip is "Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has dawned upon you." And it's taken from Isaiah 60. The logo for the apostolic voyage displays two intertwining flames, one red and the other blue, which rise from two light waves representing a boat, indicating the two Koreas, The flames wind together in order to emphasize a desire for the reunification of the two nations. And the blue waves that form the boat hold the shape of knife blades, which is a symbol of the sacrifice of the Korean martyrs made for the church.
Pope Francis' upcoming visit will mark the first time in 25 years that a pope has visited the Korean Peninsula, the last visit occurring when Blessed John Paul II came in October of 1989 following a 1984 trip where he canonized 103 Korean martyrs, including Andrew Tim Taegang, the first Korean native priest. You know, I was thinking fondly that the pope is the city he's going to. I have two friends who live there as priests, Father Pascal and then also Father John Kwan, who's here in this country now, but is from there. And so that's going to be pretty exciting because I think we're going to have a correspondent right there in the middle of it all.
Isn't that wonderful?
Isn't that great?
Yeah. They're great people, the Koreans. Their faith is so strong. Over the years, I've gotten to know some of the Korean community here on Long Island, and I'm always taken by their faith.
And I have learned so much about their culture by my friendship with these two. You know, there's a number of things, even in their own Catholicism, the way they practice, there's a tremendous respect for priests that are older. So I happen to luck out a little bit there. So there's an amazing deference to age, tradition, maturity, that it's just all part of their Catholic faith, which is interesting.
It's more than interesting. It's something for us to emulate. I mean, the reverence that they show the human person.
Exactly right.
Across the board. Everyone remembers when that little boy who sat on the Pope's chair while the Pope was delivering a homily in St. Peter's Square. Well, that little boy was the inspiration of a new short film on adoption. Let's take a look.
This image made headlines all around the world. The little Colombian boy, Didier Ferruccio, avoided the security at St. Peter's Square, gave Pope Francis a hug, and even sat on his chair. Now, the story of this boy makes its way to the silver screen. Italian actress Cristiana Capotondi mixes fiction and reality in The Pope's Chair, a short film that tells the story of Didier and his brother, two adopted children.
We wanted to tell the highlights of the Pope's first year as pontiff. Clearly, I was shocked when I saw the images of the kid who ran and sat on the Pope's chair, always staying close to him. I think that in a way, the little boy represents all of us. We all want the Pope to welcome us that way.
The film also wants to call attention on a tough reality. More than 168 million kids in the world don't have a family or are abandoned, just like little Didier, before being adopted.
We could say that I use this image to say to abandoned boys and girls living in orphanages, and also to parents who are thinking of adopting but are scared, that it is possible. It's possible to adopt children and have a happy family, no matter how difficult the process may be. Adopting in Italy, for example, is really hard, but it is possible.
After finishing her first work as director, this Italian actress assures that the experience was great and hopes The Pope's Chair really helps families thinking of adopting to take that step.
Well, that's a great idea. And that little guy, boy, let me tell you, he captured the hearts of millions and millions of people. Just seeing the images right now brings it right back, doesn't it? It was really beautiful.
It was beautiful, but all the more that now that's opened a world to people.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to be a great thing. Yeah, it could be a great thing for many, many people, of course. The canonizations of Pope John the 23rd and Pope John Paul II on April 27th will mark a historic moment for the Catholic Church. Let's take a look to see how the Vatican is preparing for this historic event.
Both the City of Rome and the Vatican are getting ready for the canonization of John Paul II and John the 23rd. Hundreds of thousands of people are expected to attend.
If St. Peter's Square is full and if the crowd extends all the way to the river, then we estimate about 200,000 to 250,000 people. It will be tight.
The Mass will be held on Sunday, April 27th at 10 a.m. Pope Francis will preside over it, but there is a possibility that another pope will be there as well.
Clearly, there's an expectation, especially after Benedict XVI attended the last consistory. In an interview, Pope Francis described him as an institution, encouraging him to take part in the life of the Church. Without a doubt, he has been invited, but it's still a month away, so we'll have to see if he decides to go.
The two women who were miraculously cured through the intercession of John Paul II will also be there. From Costa Rica, Floribeth Mora, and from France, Sister Marie-Simon-Pierre. Later that afternoon, St. Peter's Basilica will be open to the public so that pilgrims can pay before the tombs of the two new saints.
The slab that currently reads Blessed John Paul II will be changed with the word saint, so his tombstone will be replaced for the celebration.
Part of the celebration will begin a day before. On Saturday, April 26th at 9 a.m., 11 Roman parishes will be open for confession. In addition, pamphlets on the life and deeds of the future saints will be available in several languages.
The Church does not make saints. What the Church will do is recognize that these two great popes lived a saintly life.
With less than a month to go, the Vatican has launched a website for the coming canonization, tupapisanti.org. It also has a Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram account ready for the big day. It's also working on a phone app titled Santo Subito, where users can tap into the latest canonization news. And finally, on Monday, April 28th, a Mass will be held in St. Peter Square at 10 a.m. It will be celebrated by Cardinal Angelo Comastri, who serves as the Archpriest of St. Peter's Basilica.
The former press secretary to Blessed John Paul II discusses his greatest miracle. Let's take a look.
For 22 years, he worked side by side with John Paul II. As a close friend, Joaquin Navarro Val shared plenty of unforgettable moments with the Polish Pope. But one of the things he remembers most was the way he lived his everyday life.
He had a great sense of humor. He was always telling jokes and he would ask us to do the same. It's a different dimension of sanctity because it's based on everyday things. When I'm asked, did you ever see him do a miracle? I say yes. The one miracle that no one has done a book on is John Paul II's everyday life. The way he worked, how he used his time, and the way he would joke around. He had an incredible sense of humor.
As the Vatican's press secretary, he traveled along with John Paul II in 128 trips, including the Pope's visit to Cuba. They also celebrated the Jubilee year in 2000. So they were a team, but above all else, they were friends. In fact, Navarro Val says that in a way, he still feels close to John Paul II.
I've been asked, do you miss him? I say, no, I don't. People can't believe it. They say, what do you mean? You were always with him. Well, yes, that is true. When it came to work, we had to meet for about 2 to 3 hours. But now I can feel connected to him 24 hours a day. So in that sense, no, I don't miss him.
It's not every day that someone sees his former boss be declared a saint. On Sunday, April 27th, during the canonization ceremony, he says he already knows what he'll say to his friend, former boss, and future saint.
On the day of the ceremony, I will tell him, John Paul II, thank you. Thank you for turning your life into a masterpiece with the help of God.
Even though it will be a historic day in the Church, the day will be all that more special for those who personally knew the Polish Pope and who shared their day-to-day life with a future saint.
Oh, it's going to be great. I'm looking forward to this.
That's beautiful, though. Yeah. He's really looking at the fact that what it's really all about is living the life as best as we can.
Early on, I remember meeting him, and you could see, even in the presence of the Holy Father, he had such a great love, the spokesperson for the Holy Father, too. It was just a really beautiful, almost like brothers, you know.
Yes.
It was really a beautiful
yes.
thing. Just want to remind everybody, too, Telecare will be providing all of that live in beautiful quality, so you have nothing to worry about. You can catch it all live. The Mass is going to be at 4 a.m. on that Sunday. We're going to repeat it at 9 p.m., and then we'll have a live show 8 o'clock before, where we'll be right on this set, covering a lot of this great stuff that has gone on, bringing it all to you live as well. So make no plans on that Sunday night. Stick around with us and we'll have some great things to bring you with the canonization of these two great popes. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We'll be back with more AFL News right after this.
Going to school pregnant, riding the bus, that was hard. You just have all the stares and you have all the questions, and even little kids make you nervous just staring at you. When you get pregnant, all the stuff just goes through your mind. Abortion, adoption, keeping him. you're his mom. You're supposed to be the one taking care of him and raising him. But when you're 15 and pregnant, you can't do it without support. I wanted to give him a better life. When I found out I was pregnant, I don't know, just a light hit me in my heart, just saying adoption, what you need to do. I really have a simple dream. I just want to get my nursing career, get married, and have a family. When I get pregnant again, give them a better life. I'm Miranda, and I chose adoption.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. We have a lot of events to cover, so let's get started. On Friday, April 18th, from St. Peter's Basilica, the Passion of the Lord celebration at 11 a.m. From St. Agnes Cathedral, the Passion of the Lord celebration will be at 3 p.m. Also airing on Friday, live from Rome, the Way of the Cross at the Colosseum with Pope Francis, and that will be beginning at 9:30 p.m.
On Saturday, April 19th at 2:30 p.m. from St. Peter's Basilica, the Easter Vigil Mass presided over by Pope Francis. Also on Saturday from St. Agnes Cathedral, the Easter Vigil presided over by Bishop William Murphy at 8 p.m. On Sunday, April 20th, from St. Peter's Basilica, Easter Sunday Mass celebrated by Pope Francis at 4 a.m. with an encore presentation at 8 p.m.
And also on Sunday, April 20th at 6 a.m. and 10 p.m. from St. Peter's Basilica, Pope Francis' Easter Message and the Urbi et Orbi Blessing. And then from St. Agnes Cathedral on Easter Sunday, Mass presided over by Bishop Murphy at 11 a.m. and 7 p.m. from St. Patrick's Cathedral will air the Seven Last Words of Christ, which will be presided over by Cardinal Dolan at 12 p.m. So it's going to be a busy week, that's for sure. Please join me also on Good Friday and Easter Saturday when I'll be hosting the liturgical services on the Catholic Channel live from St. Patrick's Cathedral as well. So if you're on the road and you can tune into the Catholic Channel, which is channel 129, you can participate too, even via radio, which is an important thing.
To find out more about these stories and other breaking news, download the free Telecare TV app at the iTunes App Store. You can also follow us on Twitter or send us your tweets at Telecare TV. You can also like us on Facebook at facebook.com/Telecare TV. And of course, you can visit our own website at telecaretv.org.
Well, thanks for being with us, everybody. For Sister Mary Alice Peel, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlorna. We'll see you here at the same time next week. From all of us at Telecare, keep the everyday faith live. Have a blessed Easter, and God bless you and your families. It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
I trust Oceanside Christopher because not only do they have, you know, the best interest for me as a member in mind, but just they're always people helping people.
I saw firsthand during Sandy how we took care of our members.
I was one of the flood victims, and at that time when it happened, I gave up hope.
We're very grateful that we have our faith in the church and we also have our faith in the credit union.